Hey, Valleydale, welcome to the Brunson house where we've been for the last 40 years. Well, it seems like that. But next Sunday, thank the Lord, we get to come back to worship August the 2nd in person. So I'm looking forward to that. I hope you're looking forward to that. We've gone and we've talked to medical professionals. They have watched and seen what we've done, and they say, hey, it looks like you're doing everything right. So we're looking forward to being back together next Sunday. Take your copy of God's Word. Go with me, if you will, to Job chapter 25. Job chapter 25. Now, I want you to listen to what A.W. Tozer said. I love Tozer. He was a great preacher, great writer. He just wears me out. I love him. Tozer said this, and I think he's exactly right. The most important thing about you is what you believe about God. Now, let me say that again. I want you to think about that. The most important thing about you is what you believe about God. Now, Tozer said this. He believed that so much, he said that it is more disastrous for you to believe the wrong things about God than it is for you not to believe in God at all. Well, that's kind of interesting because we're going to come to two different guys this morning here in Job chapter 25, 26, 27, and I believe into 28. As we look at this, we've got two men who both believe in God, but they believe very different things about God. And one of them is going to share with you about the sovereignty of God and how not only helpful that is, but how helpful it is good for your mental and emotional health. Who you are spiritually has a tremendous impact on your mental life and on your emotional life. Now, who are the two guys? Well, Job, naturally, is one. The other happens to be Bildad. You're going to see in these third rounds of attacks by Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, what you're going to discover is this. These guys are losing it. Everything they say is shorter and shorter, and Job's response is longer and longer because Job is winning the argument, and they know it. So now take your copy of God's Word, and I want you to look there with me, and I want you just to watch, just notice what Bildad comes to Job, and he says. He begins in chapter 25, verse 1, Bildad the Shuhite answered, dominion and all belong to him. He talks about the dominion, the power of God, the strength of God. And he says, God is powerful. And then in verse 4, he comes and he says, how can man be just with God? How can fallen man, how can sinful man stand before a just God? He's talking about God's sovereignty here. He's talking about the sovereignty of God and the power of God and the greatness of God. And he concludes from that, verse 5 and verse 6. If even the moon has no brightness and the stars are not pure in his sight. Now let me translate that for you. That in the brightness of the sovereignty of God, the shining of the moon and the stars are just a smudge. He's saying this to Job. This is a slap at Job, and he's saying, Job, you think you're bright, but you are just a smudge before a sovereign God. And in fact, he's going to take it a little further, and he says this, verse 6, how much less man, that maggot, and the son of man, that worm. He says, Job, essentially, you're just a maggot before God. Now, that's the way he sees the sovereignty of God and man. That's his theology and his anthropology right there. He sees that God is sovereign, but in that, he sees that means that man is absolutely nothing but a worm before God. And this is specifically an attack at Job, because back in Job chapter 7, you may remember that we have a description of Job physically. And Job said this, my flesh is clothed with worms and a crust of dirt. My skin hardens and runs. Job had said, listen, my whole body is covered with these boils, with these open sores And then he said, there are maggots all in them. Now, I realize that's not very pleasant to think about, but that's exactly what Zophar is saying to him. He's saying, Job, as disgusting and as sickening as it is to have maggots in your sores, that is the way God sees you. Now, that is Bildad's view of the sovereignty of God. He beats Job up with the sovereignty of God. He blasts Job with the sovereignty of God. I want to tell you something. I think Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar are emotionally losing it. We saw that with Eliphaz, with his anger, his loss of temper last week. And you're seeing that now with Bildad. And I think mentally, it is describing a mental anguish, a mental struggle they are having in their own lives. Now, here is Job, who has lost everything and should be a total wreck because of that. Here's Job, who is physically ill and dying and should be a mental and emotional wreck, and he's holding together. And the question is, how is it that he holds together? It's because of his view of God. How you see God. The most important thing about you is what you think of God. And Job sees that God, listen, he sees that the sovereignty of God builds hope within a man's life. And it doesn't blast him, it blesses him. That I have a sovereign God is a blessing mentally and emotionally and even physically to my life. That God is in control. Listen, the sovereignty of God can take meaningless suffering and shift it into purposeful maturity. Now, let me say that again. The sovereignty of God can change the meaningless suffering of life into purposeful maturing. And that's exactly where you see Job this morning. Now, I want you to see, as Job responds to this, the three things that he's going to say. Chapter 26, 27, 28. We'll look at them quickly, but watch this with me. Chapter 26, he begins with this, looking at the sovereignty of God. He comes and he speaks of the incomprehensible preeminence of God. In other words, the preeminence of God is beyond anything that we can think of. It's incomprehensible, the greatness of our God. And he begins with these words. Job responded to Bildad with these words, "What a help you are to the weak." In other words, thanks for nothing. How you have saved the arm without strength. What counsel you have given to one without wisdom. Now, I want you to notice something. He's basically saying thanks for nothing, but he's made three statements about the weakness of man. He says he's weak. He says he speaks of the arm without strength, and he speaks of one without wisdom. And so he puts man in proper perspective. He puts anthropology here in the proper perspective, and that is man is weak and has no strength when you compare him to Almighty God. And so he says, you've done me no good. I was weak. I was without wisdom. I was without any strength whatsoever. And he says, nothing you have said has helped me whatsoever. It's done no good. But now watch it, what he does. He's going to turn that now. He essentially admits, I know I'm weak. I know I have no strength. I know I have no wisdom. But now watch it, what he does. He turns that and he focuses it on God. He says, but let me tell you about God. He says, I'm going to share with you about this incomprehensible preeminence, the greatness of our God. And he's going to begin with the dead. He's going to talk about the preeminence of God over the dead. Now watch verse 5. The departed spirits tremble under the waters and their inhabitants. Naked is Sheol before him, and Abaddon has no covering. Abaddon literally in the Hebrew means the place of destruction. It describes what death does to the human body. It decays it. Now he has talked about departed spirits, Sheol, which is the place where departed spirits live in the Old Testament, and Abaddon, the destruction of the grave. And so he is saying this. He is saying God is God over all of that. He is the God who rules over all of that, even the place of the dead, even Sheol. In fact, if you've got your Bibles, look with me at Psalm 139. And I want you to listen to David as David writes about this. Psalm 139 is a tremendous psalm. And in verse 7, listen to what David says. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. Verse 12, even the darkness is not dark to you, and the night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light are alike to you. He says, there's nowhere I can go that God, you don't see it, that you're not there, that you even peer through the darkness, and darkness doesn't even hide your ability to see my life or where I am or my circumstances or my situation. Here's Job, who thinks he's dying and has been told by his three friends, you're as good as dead, this is where you're headed. He says that doesn't make any difference because even there in that place is the incomprehensible preeminence of my God. He is sovereign even over the place of the dead. Now watch this. The second thing that he says is this, he is preeminent over the place of the living. Where do we live on this earth? Verse 7, he stretches out the north over empty space. Now he's talking about space. He's talking about outer space. Now, how does Job know anything about that? Well, watch this. And hangs the earth on nothing. Do you see that? Do you want some apologetics this morning? How do we know this is the Word of God? That was not the scientific view of that day. The ancient Egyptians believed that the earth rested on the back of a giant tortoise. That's what the ancient Egyptians believed. The ancient Greeks believed that the earth rested on the shoulders of Atlas. Now that was the theological view of that day. Here's Job at least 2,000 years before Christ, who says God has hung the world on nothing. How did he know that? Word of God. There you go. Look at verse 8. He wraps up the waters in his clouds, and the clouds does not burst under them. Do you know what he's describing there? He's describing this whole thing of condensation, how the sun draws water up into the clouds, and the clouds move, and at a certain time, all that condensation comes down in the form of rain back on the earth. That was not known. The whole process of condensation wasn't known until the 1700s. How did he know that? Word of God. Verse 9, he obscures the face of the full moon and spreads his cloud over it. And he has inscribed a circle on the surface. Do you know what he's saying there? That the earth is a globe. How in the world, some 3,500 years before Columbus, did he understand that the world was a globe? Word of God. This is amazing. You dazzle your friends at work tomorrow morning with what Job has said right here. He comes and he says, behold, all these things that he said about God. God is the God who has created all of this. He rules over it. He reigns over it. He is the incomprehensible, preeminent God over life and death. And listen to what he says in verse 14. Behold, these are the fringes of his ways. He says, what we know about God, that has even been revealed to us about God, we have only touched the fringe of the garment of the sovereignty of God. Now there's his response. This sounds like a very mentally, emotionally healthy man. Though he is sick, though he has lost everything, look at what he believes about God and how it has impacted his life. Look at the second thing. He comes in chapter 27 and he speaks of the impeccable justice of God. That is, it is flawless. The justice of God is flawless. The justice of God is perfect in every situation. We have people in America today that are marching in the streets for justice. And I've got news for you. We're never going to have justice apart from the rule and the reign of Jesus Christ. Never. Should we stop striving for it? No. What we should do is we should go tell the world what I just told you, and that is there will be no justice for anybody in this world until we recognize the lordship of Jesus Christ. Listen to what Job is going to say right here. He's going to come and he's going to point this out. He's going to talk about where life comes from. And he's going to say, God is just in all of this. For as long as life is in me and the breath of God is in my nostrils. Now just stop with that. Because Job has just stated that all of this in his life, he doesn't understand. Why is God letting this happen to me? Why is this taking place? God lives, as God lives, who has taken away my right, and the Almighty who has embittered my soul. As long as I have life in me and the breath of God is in my nostrils, he says, I don't understand what God is doing to me. I can't figure it out. However, what I do know is this, I have life because there is a God. God is the God of life. Now notice what he's going to say about it. He's going to say, far be it from me, verse 5, that I should declare you right. Till I die, I will not put away my integrity from me. Now, what he's saying is this. Let me tie all of that together. He's saying, God gives me life. I don't understand God's plan for my life, but I know God gives me life. And he says, as far as I'm concerned, I will never admit that you are right about what you're saying about me. Job says, I never said that I was perfect. Job says, I never said that I have never sinned. That's not what Job is saying. Job is saying, I've repented before God, and what I'm going through is not because of my sin. There is something else going on in my life, and in the end, this is what Job is saying, God is a God who is just. God is the God who will work all this out in justice. He's the God who gives me life, and at the end of my life, God will prove that he is just. He comes in verse 7 and he says, my enemy may be as the wicked, my opponent as the unjust. For what is the hope of the godless when he is cut off, when God requires his life? What will God hear his cry when distress comes upon him? Will he take delight in the Almighty? Will the wicked take delight in the Almighty and call on God at all times? What Job is saying is this, wicked people don't call on God. What have I been doing this entire time? I've been calling on God. He says, I'm not wicked. I'm not in rebellion against God. But what I am going to do is this. Now listen, Eliphaz, Bildad, Zophar, you are not the final analysis in life. God is. God is a just God who is going to make every wrong right one day. May not be today, may not be tomorrow, but at some point, God will make every wrong right. Now, let me give you a little illustration of that. Here's an interesting little story. Several years ago in Los Angeles, in the circuit court system out there, there was a judge by the name of Yankovich. Yankovich had a case, a civil case, that came before him with two guys suing each other. One was the name Luther Wright, and the other was Herman Wrong. And in that civil case, Yankovich, the judge, said, here is my rendering. Right is wrong, and wrong is right, and that is my judgment. Kind of an interesting play. He says, the judge made the comment, he says, as paradoxical as it seems, right is wrong and wrong is right. Now listen, I'm telling you this. There's coming a day when God will take every wrong and he will flip it on its head and he will make it all right. That is what Job is saying right here. He is saying, guys, you don't have the final say on everything. God does. Now, here's the third thing I want you to see. It's in chapter 28, and it's this. It's the indescribable wisdom of God. You cannot describe God's wisdom, and Job is going to say three things about that. Watch it, what he does. Beginning in verse 1, he's going to say this: you just don't stumble across wisdom. You don't need to think that as you grow older, well, I'm just going to stumble across wisdom one day and I'll suddenly become wise. Listen to what he says. Surely there is a mine for silver and a place where they refine gold. In other words, wisdom can be found somewhere. He's talking about man going and working for it. He's working to find silver. He's working to find gold. Verse 2, iron is taken from the dust. Copper is smelted from rock. Man puts an end to darkness, and to the furthest limit he searches out the rock in gloom and deep shadow. He sinks a shaft far from habitation. Forgotten by the foot, they hang and swing to and fro far from men. In other words, they're digging down in these holes. I have literally been deep in the Negev, in the Sinai, to where Solomon had his copper and silver and gold mines. I've been there. They would dig shafts down and they would lower men. That's what he's talking about, swinging to and fro. They would go down in that shaft and dig that stuff out and send it back up. And he's talking about man coming and working for it. You're not going to get wisdom in that way. You're not going to somehow dig wisdom out of whatever you're digging in. You're not going to stumble across it. There is wisdom, but that's not going to come to you by working and seeking to dig it out somewhere, no matter how much energy you exert. The second thing that he comes and says is this, is that you can't buy wisdom. Look at verse 12. He comes and he says, but where can wisdom be found, and where is the place of understanding? Man doesn't even know its value, nor is it found in the land of the living. Verse 15, pure gold cannot be given in exchange for it, nor can silver be weighed out as its price. He says you can take gold and silver down to the store, but you can't buy wisdom. You're not going to get on Amazon and have a package of wisdom sent to your house. You're not going to go down to Walmart and down at Walmart, take hard currency if you want to and buy a box of wisdom. You can't get it that way. Look at this third thing. Now, here's a man, I'm telling you, this has impacted his emotional and his mental health. He is in better mental health. He is in better emotional health than his three friends that nothing has happened to. Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar are all healthy. They're all wealthy men. They're all famous men. They're all well-known men. But they are not mentally in a good place because they've got the wrong view of God. He comes to the third thing, and watch this. The third thing is this. You can't be taught wisdom. I can't sit you down and teach you wisdom. Where then does wisdom come from? Verse 20. And where is the place of its understanding? Thus it is hidden from the eyes of all the living and concealed from the birds of the sky. Abaddon, place of destruction, and death say, with our ears, we've heard the report of it. We've heard about it. We've just never had it. Look at this. Verse 23. God understands its way and he knows its place. You can't go to a university. You're not going to get into a Zoom class at a university and get wisdom. You're not going to go and sit in a class and get wisdom. Where is wisdom? It is with God. The most important thing about your life is what you believe about God. Listen to what Job says. Man looks to the ends of the earth, sees everything under the heavens. When he imparted weight to the wind and meted out the waters by measure, that is when God did that, when God set a limit to the rain and a course for the thunderbolt, when God saw it and declared it and established it and also stretched it out, to man he said, now here you come, here's the answer to this, where is wisdom? Behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to depart from evil is understanding. There is the sovereignty of God. It is the sovereignty of God over all of life and death. There's the sovereignty of God over the justice of man. There's the sovereignty of God over wisdom, of knowing the right thing to do and the wrong thing. And God says it all begins when you believe me and believe in me. I don't know if you've seen the movie Greyhound yet. It's on Apple. I'm not doing a commercial for Apple. I am telling you it's a great movie with Tom Hanks. As Churchill called it, the Battle of the Atlantic, the North Atlantic. There was an area called the Black Pit. That was about 50 hours across that part of the North Atlantic where the Wolf Pack, the U-boats of the Germans were sinking everything that was coming across there. Tens of thousands of men lost their lives in that part of the North Atlantic. It's where these planes could not go. Planes from America would reach their limit and would have to turn back. And planes from Great Britain couldn't come out all that way because of the limit of their gasoline reserves. And so these ships, these convoy ships, had this place about 50 hours where they had to traverse that was perilous because of these German submarines. Well, Tom Hanks is the captain. There are four destroyers, two from England, one from Poland, I believe, one from the United States, that's protecting this convoy of about 37 ships, thousands of men, millions of tons of provision headed to England for the war. And Hanks plays this captain of the lead destroyer, the lead escort ship, who is to keep these U-boats away. In the movie starts with Hanks on his knees praying for God's protection. It's a fascinating, fascinating look at a true account, or the account of that. The story is not actually true, but it's what happened to all of these ships that went through that area. Of the stress, you see the man under tremendous anxiety. He keeps calling the young men around him by the wrong name, and it just shows his humanity. It shows his own inner struggle. He was in love with a young lady. She did not want to get married until after the war, and yet he would not let that discourage him, as in love with her as he was, but it was a blow. Everything comes as a blow, but he navigates these ships. He doesn't get them all there. A number of them are destroyed, but he basically gets the bulk of the convoy through that dark pit of the North Atlantic. And you wonder, how does the man hold it together? How is he holding together with all of this pressure and tension and stress and anxiety? You come to the end of the movie. He hasn't slept now for about 48, 50 hours or so. He's not had any sleep. He's not had a bite to eat. He's just had a couple of cups of coffee. How in the world does he hold it together? You come to the end of the movie and you find him back where he was at the beginning of the movie. He is on his knees in prayer, thanking God for God's protection. And it closes with him getting in the bed and going to sleep. There is the sovereignty of God and the wisdom of God, that no matter how hard the circumstance, no matter how difficult the situation, the strain, the anxiety, the struggle, you make it through it. Not because you know theology, but because you know God. What you believe about God is the most important thing in your life. Trust in Jesus. Would you bow your heads with me right now? Those of you that are not a part of Valley Dale, but you have tuned in this morning, maybe God's speaking to your heart. I hope he's speaking to the hearts of those that are members of Valley Dale as well. But maybe you're watching this morning and you've never put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ. And you've wondered, how do I make it through a difficult life? How do I make it through parenthood? How do I make it through marriage? How do I make it through a work life where the work world is as crazy and as vicious and as difficult as it is? How do we make it through these trying times that seem so chaotic? One day you hear this, the next day you hear the opposite, and the day after that you hear something else. Listen, let me tell you something. Wisdom comes from a sovereign God. And if you want to mentally and emotionally hang together, then spiritually, you've got to settle the issue of who God is in your life. Jesus Christ. And He's come because He loves you. And He died on a cross to give you salvation. And if you've never put your faith and your trust in Him, I don't know a better time than right now for you to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Why don't you pray with me right now? All of you that are wondering, can I do this? Yes, you can. Can I have salvation today? You can have it right now in this moment. Just by simply doing this, Lord Jesus, I confess that I'm a sinner. And I'm asking You to forgive me of my sins. And I come to You and I thank You, Jesus, for dying on a cross for me and being raised from the dead to give me eternal life. And I put my faith and my trust and my hope and my love in You and in Your grace and in Your mercy and in Your forgiveness. And I do it in Jesus' name. Amen. Didn't cost You a dime. You could not earn that. You could not buy that. You could not purchase that. But it comes to you free from a God who loves you. Now, if you just prayed that prayer, there's a hand there. You click that hand to let us know that you've prayed to receive Christ. Others of you that are watching us regularly, we've become your church home. We'd love to minister to you. We're not going to hound you, but we want to help disciple you. What you can do is you can get on valleydale.org/family. And you can be a part of the Valleydale family. We would love to be able to put you in some Bible study groups, to pray with you, to pastor you as best we can until you can get into a local congregation somewhere. So you give us that information. Go there, fill that out, become a friend of Valleydale, and we'll do everything we can to be a good church and be responsible for you and with you. Until Wednesday night, God bless.